gather for worship on this sacred night, we come with heavy hearts as we face the reality of the crucifixion, the death of Jesus. And so as we worship, there is no bulletin tonight, but we will be focusing on the seven last words that Jesus shares, the seven last phrases from the cross. That frames our worship, and then as the night gathers and the words are shared, the lights will be dimmed. We'll end the service in relative darkness. I would invite you to leave the sanctuary then in solemn silence. Also today, especially in prayer, we will be lifting up the family of Jared Reed. Jared passed away earlier this week, his funeral service in the sanctuary this morning. And then also our prayers for Bob Gassaway and his family. Bob's wife, Lillian, passed away this morning. Services will be on Tuesday morning here in the sanctuary, and visitation in Homedale, the funeral home, on Monday, late afternoon and early evening. And so our hearts go out to all who are grieving, but we do not grieve alone. We have the love of a Savior through whom his suffering, we then are promised life. Let us worship God. We gather in many and various places to worship God on this holy evening.
We gather separately, but together, to remember how Jesus suffered and died for us, and to thank God for his love.
This suffering servant had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief.
Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows.
He was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities.
Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole.
And with his stripes we are healed.
All we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way.
And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all.
Come, let us worship the Lord who was obedient, even to death on a cross.
Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
I was struck by a comment from an article that I read this past week by Debi, an author, a pastor. And she wrote, "I admire people who take up crosses for the greater good. The surgeon who sacrifices a prestigious career to serve a backwater community. The gutsy journalist who risks her reputation to expose corruption close to home. the ordinary wage earner who donates every last penny to a cause that he deems urgent. But not all crosses are so shiny, salvific, and impressive. There are other kinds too, kinds we don't choose, crosses that confuse. As we're now moving through a second Lenten season under the shadows of COVID-19, I'm thinking about crosses that just don't seem to make sense, crosses that baffle. What does it mean to take up our cross? The cross of isolation, the cross of grief, the cross of agony? The very first person to literally take up his cross, we read in Scripture, was Simon of Cyrene. What was the point of that? Simon shows up at history's darkest hour, when Jesus, the Messiah, had fallen on the roadside as he was carrying his cross, bidden to do so by Roman authorities, as he had been condemned to die. So as Jesus carried his cross to that spot on Golgotha outside the city wall, he stumbles and falls. And the Romans call from the crowd, "You! Yes, you, come, carry the cross." In that tense standstill, the Roman soldiers, whose job it was to execute Jesus, have now called upon Simon and forced him to do what Jesus at that moment couldn't. Simon, we don't know much about him. We knew that he was a pilgrim coming to Jerusalem from Africa for the Passover feast. So Simon's simply there for a religious obligation, a bystander. And now he gets pulled from obscurity into the center of one of the greatest dramas ever. Conscripted under Roman law, he has no choice but to obey. And so, yes, we don't know much more about him. Before this, after this, we don't know whether this encounter changed him somehow, whether perhaps it led to a conversion. We don't know. But I wonder if he wondered, why me? Why me? Out of all the people in all of Jerusalem, why did they pick me? I think sometimes we too are called into another person's suffering. Sometimes it is because we choose to. There is a compelling sense in which we want to enter into another person's grief. But there may be those times when we enter into that time, oh, so reluctantly. We just happen to be the right person at the right time, called upon to do the right thing. So Simon does what he needs to, even though it doesn't change the outcome. Jesus is still crucified. And we do the same. We are called out of obscurity to do the right thing at the right time, even if it doesn't change the outcome. We make meals for a neighbor, knowing that the cancer diagnosis still remains. We send checks to our favorite charities, knowing that for every bit of money that check the child gets temporarily fed, there's going to be tens of thousands of other children that don't. We linger at the bedsides of loved ones affected with dementia, knowing full well that no matter how long we stay, they're not going to remember once we leave. We pray for an end to systemic injustice or political corruption or the crisis that seems to be enveloping us all the time. And we understand that our prayers may not see fruition for months, or years, or decades, perhaps centuries. Oh, please, God, hear us, come, Lord Jesus. So when we're called to take up a cross, we do so knowing that a cross isn't something that you can solve. It's something that you carry. Crosses, I find, are both a burden and a blessing. They weigh us down, but they also change us. Sometimes we bear those crosses resentfully, but I know we also bear those same crosses out of love. For the pain that enters into our lives can both somehow deform us, but also transform us over and over and over again. That's the road that Simon walked. That's the cross that Simon carried. And that's the road that we walk with and for Jesus. That's the cross that we carry with and for Jesus, until resurrection comes. Help us, Lord Jesus. We give thanks for the grace of your presence, for truly by your stripes we are healed. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus, on the cross you took up the final, most agonizing part of your task on earth, and it was there that you interceded between us and sin. You wrestled with all that separates us from you, and today you call us to intercede for others. So we pray. We pray for those who are suffering from loss. We pray for Jared Reed's family. We pray for Lillian Gassaway's family. We pray for all who are grieving, for the loved ones who have died. We pray for those who have experienced the loss of dreams, the loss of health, the loss of a job, the loss of a pet, the loss of a marriage, the loss of mental acuity. The losses are many, and so, O Lord, we pray. And we pray for those who put their lives at risk, serving in the military, the police, the fire department. We pray for those who love them. We pray for governmental leaders, grant wisdom and compassion. We pray for those who are marginalized because of their sexual orientation or their racial heritage or their lack of status. Lord, even on this Good Friday, we know that you have conquered death once and for all. Therefore, we turn all of our concerns over to you, placing those who sorrow and fear and despair in your care. Shine as a beacon into our lives as we survey the wondrous cross, where the whole realm of nature causes us to tremble, for it was even still present, far too small. Your love, so amazing, so divine, demands all. Amen.
please, Jesus. But they shouted out, "Crucify, crucify him." A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I found in him no crime deserving death. I will therefore chastise him and release him." But they were urgent, demanding with loud cries that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave sentence that their demand should be granted. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for resurrection and murder, whom they asked for, but Jesus delivered up to their will. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place which is called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and one on the left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments. The word of God.
They do not know what they are doing. They do not know. And who is they? I mean, it's so easy to name others, to blame others. The Romans, the crowd, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas. Yes, they all played their part and conspired against Jesus. They all wanted to keep Jesus' kingdom from impinging upon theirs. Surely Jesus could have raged at the sinners who nailed him to the tree. But then again, surely Jesus could be raging at us for our sins that we do knowingly and unknowingly. And yet there is compassion in the first words that Jesus utters from the cross. He intercedes for us before the Father. For it was compassion that marked his earthly ministry. It was compassion that compelled him to the cross. Compassion that brings indelible and amazing grace. Compassion that echoes through the centuries. And it is compassion that echoes from the cross as Jesus says, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do."
A reading from Luke 23, verses 35 through 43. And the people stood by watching, but the rulers scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up, offering him vinegar, and saying, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanging there railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we, indeed, under the same, for we are receiving the same due reward for our deeds. But this man's done nothing wrong. And then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
How much are we like that first thief, full of anger because we have not been rescued from our sins, our ailments, our present situation? Oh, how we might want God to just snap fingers and make right what is so wrong. And so we join in that cry, save us. And we wait for some miraculous recovery, or perhaps legions of angels to come and take away every anxiety or uncertainty, to bring wholeness. And yet there is good news. There is a cure for sin, a cure that does not promise magical solutions, but promises that the pain of sin is not the end. That when all is over, when the suffering is finished and that final word is not that of trials or of temptations, not of disease, not of defeat, but the last word is that of life, life transformed, for life is fulfilled in paradise. And so to the compassionate thief, and to us, to the ones who can still recognize that there is yet good in this world, to the ones who try to comfort and to protect, pardon is given and blessing is proclaimed. Today, you will be with me in paradise.
John 19. So the soldiers did this, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Who can fully grasp the grief? The grief of Mary watching her son suffer. The grief of Mary watching him die. And who can grasp the grief of the son? The son who must see his mother mourn. What gift can a man give his mother? What can he offer her for the time when he is gone? How can he help, hold her, comfort her, honor her? Woman, here is your son. Here is one I love, to love you, and for you, in return, to love. One who knows me, one who followed me, and one who shares your grief. For mother, you have taught me and fed me and wiped away my tears, and now you grieve with unutterable loss. When there is love, there's risk. And when there is that risk, there is the opportunity for unsurpassed joy. But there is also the possibility of unutterable loss. Women, behold your children, and children, behold your mothers.
A reading from Mark 15. And it was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." So also the chief priests mocked him to one another with the scribes, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we might see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Of all the agony of that torturous day, the lacerations of the scourging, the chafing of the crown of thorns on his head, nothing reaches the depths of agony as that anguished cry of desolation, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Jesus found his strength, his purpose in the presence of God, and yet here and now he finds himself alone, hanging on a cross. Jesus, whose very being was God, found himself absolutely despairingly cut off from the very source of his being as he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And yet, Those are not unfamiliar words, for they are the very words that begin the 22nd Psalm. So even in their heart-wrenchingness, the plea of agony, this also becomes, for Jesus and for us, a cry that is yet still based in faith. Thus, for us in these words, we sense the central mystery of the crucifixion, which cannot really totally ever completely be comprehended, that there is no despair so deep, no evil so overwhelming, or place that is so far removed from joy or light or love that God cannot meet us, and in which God will not bring us home.
John 19. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A bowl full of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of the vinegar on a hyssop and held it to his mouth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
There is a kind of timelessness about hanging on a cross. It's not a quiet death. It's not something that is over in one glorious moment of martyrdom. No, as the day wears on, seconds stretch into minutes, which stretch into hours, until there comes a point where time can no longer be measured except in the gradual weakening of the body and its ever-insistent demands for that substance which is so vital to life, so basic to existence as we know it, water. Water to moisten a parched mouth. Water to open a rasping throat that cannot gasp enough air. Water to keep hope alive just for a few moments longer. O God, thou art my God, I seek thee. My soul thirsts after thee, my flesh pants for thee, as in a dry and weary land where no water is. Who can tell if these words from Psalm 63 went through Jesus' mind? But a thirst for water is a thirst for life, and a thirst for life is a thirst for God. Here at the end of it all, those promises seem so far away, distant, and yet Jesus still yet clings to the memory and to that hope for life. I thirst.
A reading from John 19. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." He bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, in order to prevent the bodies from remaining on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, that you may also believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not a bone of him shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Almost a sigh of relief, a cry of deliverance, that finally, after seemingly endless pain and gasping torment, it is over at last, the suffering ended, the ordeal finished. When all that there is pain, the ceasing of that is a blessing, even when that ceasing comes with death. But Jesus' cry here at the end is more than just the welcoming of the ending of pain. It is more than just a relief at the deliverance that death brings, because he does not just simply say, "It is over." No, rather, Jesus says, "It is finished. It is accomplished. It is achieved. It is fulfilled." All that Jesus came to do has been fulfilled. And thus it is not a cry of defeat or despair. It is a cry of success and triumph and completion, even now at this, the very moment of death. For the race has been run, and Jesus has endured, even to the end. The strife bore, the battle won. For Jesus' cry is a cry of relief, to be sure, but also a cry of victory. The work that I have come to do is complete. There is nothing more to add. It is finished. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. while the sun's light failed and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Here it is at the end, the very end, the end of the ordeal, the end of the suffering, and Jesus alone on the cross, tortured, exhausted, abandoned by friends, seemingly forsaken by God. He gasps for a last breath and gathers the strength for one final cry. Why would he choose to speak so close to the end? A dedication made despite the pain, despite the mocking, despite the agony. A dedication made to God before the resurrection, before the victory, before any other assurance other than that which faith could bring. Jesus entrusts his life and his death to God in faith. Even at the close, Jesus proclaims his faith in God. The darkness cannot, will not, and will never overcome it. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Jesus said, "In this world you will encounter trials and temptations, and yet take courage, for I have overcome the world." Jesus has come to bring us peace, for he says, "Peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give unto you, but let not your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid." May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you, to be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, to give you peace. Both this time, this